Hello friends, I'm Jonar. Thank you for having me here in beautiful Auckland. I remember I only once went to a school reunion, and you know, you forget people's names and faces until you see them. And a guy walks up to me carrying two Jim Beam bottles, one in each hand as his idea of a balanced diet. And he says, "Hey Jonar, what you do for a job now, mate?" I thought, this guy is a stirrer. So I thought I'd pick the most interesting thing I do. I said, "Richie, I'm a futurist." And he laughed, a big fat belly laugh, and said, "You're always the weird one." I thought, yeah, he's probably got a point, but hang on a minute, Richie, what do you do? He said, "I am a lecturer at Sydney University, and he lectures in history." I said, "Hang on a minute, how come it's honourable and noble to go backwards in time and explore history, and it's weird to be a futurist?" Well, I think it's maybe because people don't understand what a futurist does. They probably think we sit there with a crystal ball. Well, we don't. We try to understand the market and the technology and the changes and society and the laws and religion so that we can come back to governments and corporations and say, look, we're not sure which way it could go, but it could definitely go this way and this way and this way. And these are the possible bridges to get you there in readiness for this future. So a futurist is not a crystal baller, but someone who can build the bridges into the potential future. And yet we all want a better future. So why aren't we all futurists? Let's go through a few of the topics that we'll be covering today. And one of them is, why is it that people, with all the benefit of hindsight, history really, still fail? When the future hits some people, it hits them in the face like a brick wall, like it's a grand surprise. Let's look at some of the reasons why people fail and yet others succeed brilliantly. Well, the first reason I think people fail to embrace the future and be successful and solid in the future is that they adopt the wait and see approach. Now, this is born from a bit of complacency, a bit of fear, a bit of trepidation, but also born from this thing that I believe that in life, those who are content are the richest of all. And so as we mature, we become a little bit more content. But I have to say, in business, those who are content are sitting ducks. This is a dichotomy in life. We leave home wanting to be content. Once we hit the office, we cannot be content. We must always grow in three-dimensional terms, like a tomato grows on a vine. Growth isn't just opening another office or having a lot of money. It has to be three-dimensional in the way we talk, we think, we move, we interact. And so comes something new, we think, oh, we'll wait and see. Well, what are you going to do, for example, if you had a big collection of VHS tapes and this is important for your business, let's say? And then someone says to you, why aren't you upgrading to DVD? You say, look, I'll just wait and see. Look, that is such a terrible syndrome in which to get, because eventually these tapes are going to get old and dusty and dirty and they're going to be oxidized. And then if your machine is failing, who's going to repair your VCR? Where do you get the spare parts for it? This is an analogy and a real life example of how you just cannot wait and see. You must get on the bandwagon and continue to grow. And it's not perfect. And as new things come along, what are you waiting for? For it to get perfect? You'll be usurped every single time. So we must embrace it, even though it sometimes hurts, and grow our people so that they are not foreigners in the future. A lot of people seem to think they need a passport into the future. They need a visa, because to them it's somewhere most foreign. They don't even speak the language. There begins the reason why they fail. Another reason is this thing called SAF, surprise absorption factor. A car has a bumper bar. It gives you a bit of absorption. Your running shoes absorb you as you're running. Well, where in business do we have this absorption for when new things happen? New markets open up, new competitors come out of left field you never even imagined. And so organisations, though they put some money aside for superannuation and health and sickness, and they put some money aside in case, but have they put some training aside in case we need to move forward? Or we just wait? And that's the problem. We need to be ready at least for some of those bridges and some of those scenarios. It has to be part of the boardroom discussion. Another reason I think organisations fail is the incumbency. sometimes we are our own worst enemy. For example, let's say you and I invested well and we opened a bookshop. And the bookshop's doing so well, we start to franchise it. And before we know it, we have 200 franchisees or franchise owners. They've mortgaged their home, they've paid us $200,000, they've fitted their store with $1 million worth of stock and fittings. Then we hear that .com is coming. And we raise at the meeting, hey guys, we're a great book chain, but let's go online. And I've been in this scenario before. They all vote no, because I've invested $200,000, they say. Why would you go online and compete with me and take away from my patch? And so we start to have these long-winded debates. Now we are encumbered. Incumbency slows us down. Now take Barnes & Noble and Borders Books. In the US, they had the market sewn up. Between them, they had 801 stores and they had 51,000 employees. I call them 51,000 brains. How can 51,000 brains, 801 stores, cornered the entire market, couldn't think of Amazon.com? Where did this guy Jeff come from? He came from his mother's garage, a man who was unencumbered, didn't have to put up with the meetings and the, excuse me, and I beseech thee, and no, you know, hitherto, henceforth. No, mate, he wanted to do it, he did it. And so sometimes you just need to be able to branch out and say, and this is actually what happened with the IBM PC. The IBM PC would never have happened if it were embraced by IBM. Actually, IBM did not want the PC. It was a little toy, they said. So much so, they kicked them out of the office and sent them to Boca Raton because they needed the floor space. If they hadn't kicked them out to Boca Raton, they would have been sacked or reassigned to another division. And then when IBM was failing by the tunes of billions, someone said, hang on a minute, do you want to talk to us at Boca Raton? Look at this thing we've created, the PC that changed so many things. But it was incubated away from the very deep thinkers who doubt and who don't invest. Okay, so another reason perhaps organizations would fail is that they're too expert. You see, they're all noble reasons. You're so good at what you do that you're too stuck in what you do. Can you imagine if you go to a carpenter and say, I'd like you to build me a shelf for my books? I bet you within a nanosecond the carpenter's thinking wood. You go to a metal worker and say the same thing, instantly they're thinking metal. The expert will think by what they know, and that is called magnetic thinking. It's automatic, and that's how they visualize the world. So you ask someone who makes glassware, come on guys, we've got to be innovative, we've got to grow, and they'll put their brains together, and they will do their best and produce beautiful products, but they're still made of glass. What knowledge do they have? What absorption have they had to train somebody in plasticware? Oh no, we're just dealing glass. Okay, so Jeff will come along and introduce a whole new Tupperware range and usurp you. Now what are you going to do? So the experts need to sometimes step out of what they know and learn something else. And this is called buffery. You've got to buff yourselves. Another reason that organizations fail to embrace the future, and the future to them is a massive surprise, is that they lose touch. So they might, through every survey under the sun, produce the best shoe in the world. And every tennis player who uses these shoes will tell you they're comfortable, they're good, I'm happy with it. And so, if you go along as a futurist and say to them, look, the bridges are pointing this way and you're going that way, how are you going to cross over? They go, no, everything is fine. But they've lost touch with the idea of who makes the decision to buy the shoe, and that the influencer is not necessarily the tennis player. It might well be the celebrity on stage singing on an electric guitar, and what they're wearing influences the sale. And this is about understanding markets in a whole different way. Let's look now at some of these surprising wild cards that come along. Out of the blue, oh my goodness, who would have thought of that? And wild cards really like tug the boat completely in another direction, and it'll grab you by the throat and either drag you or kill you. One of the things is what I call an intangible of life, and that is this instant disloyalty has become a wild card that can just make or break a business. I say, and as a technologist I say, we are more disconnected today than ever before. Isn't that wild? Every website in the world has a contact us section, and I do all these surveys, and one day I might share with you these surveys. It is unbelievable how long it takes for anyone to respond to a contact us section. So the consumer has no real belief that they are in any way connected with the company. And so when they feel upset and disconnected, they no longer care so much to explain to you why they're unhappy. So the unhappy conversation hardly takes place anymore. They just switch. And that's the instant disloyalty that is very scary. Now, in business today, I bet you most organizations can tell you anything and everything. Take baked beans. Take a can of baked beans. At the moment, the owners of these or manufacturers can tell you who bought them, where, what postcode, and through the flyby system and the credit system at most supermarkets, they can tell you how old the consumer was, what time of day they bought, did they buy the one with tomato sauce or not. They can tell you anything and everything, except there's one column always missing, and that's called why the customer decided not to buy. We know who bought, we know where they bought, but we don't know the instant a customer decided not to buy. That is the scariest column, it's always missing, and we don't know. So, instant disloyalty, bang, can't explain it, sorry, you're gone. Another one is this thing that in the good old days, we used to assume that things had a gradual decline. So if we came to the meeting and we said, look, sales are down by 5%, we don't panic, we still go to lunch and have a good time. Sales are down by 7%, it's okay. We think 5 and 7 is far away from 100, we've got plenty of time to recover. What a lot of people don't understand about the future is that there are sometimes cliffs and you just go way over the cliff because the whole Rubik's Cube of your business cannot sustain a steady decline. It's a zip down. The Rubik's Cube cannot maintain. It's a viability question. You've heard of demographics. That means what you earn, where you live, how many children you have, what postcode, what car you drive, how old you are, etc. Demographics. Then you've heard of psychographics, psyche, how you feel, what you believe, what religion you might follow, what you think of abortion, what you think of boat people, asylum seekers, and so on. Your psyche. A wild card that is impacting people's ability to jump the bridge and get to the other side, to the future, is a thing called dispographics. One's disposition. Now that is still an intangible, and all of life happens in the intangibles. When people put their head to the pillow at night, the thing that torments them most is not the color of their car. It is about love and lust and hate and fear and intimidation and bullying and anxiety and hope. All these things are intangibles that consume us as we put our head to the pillow. And these intangibles live as well to torment our business. Dispographics means the customer's disposition. So I tried to prove this to my students once, and during a fair or a fete that was held by the church or the local mayor in our town, we held two little booths that sold these thick shakes, milkshakes. And they had exactly the same ingredients, the same milk and the same ice cream. Except one of them was beautifully decked out with nice clothes for the people serving, lovely branding, the ladle for the milk looked beautiful, the milk came in a lovely little tub, that's the one. And on the other side was the really sort of rough and ready, open the ice cream out of the plastic as it was, plastic spoon, plastic cup. And we, actually physically demonstrated this, that the kiddies would just be drawn like a magnet to the other one, to the good one, to the flashy one. It's about the experience and the sense of adventure. Now, in Sydney today, there's a new ice cream store. While other ice cream stores are shutting down, there's a new ice cream store called N2. N stands for nitrogen. And outside this store in Chinatown, humongous aluminium-looking nitrogen tanks, two of them. And when you ask for an ice cream, they pour a little bit of chocolate liquid, which is like a hot chocolate situation. And then they open the nitrogen tanks and they're dressed in their dorky Virgil glasses from Virgil from the, what's that show called? Thank you, Thunderbirds. And then they're wearing lab coats and they've got a Bunsen burner on the bench so when they give you one with the sugar, they burn the sugar. And on it goes, this whole experience. And then when they open the liquid nitrogen, it pours out and you've got this white smoke just billowing out like something beautiful out of a morning mist. And the ice cream is good, but exorbitantly priced. And the queues go on and on to the point where you have to walk like this to pick up your order. While other stores are shutting down. It is unbelievable. What is that? People are predisposed to things that touch humanity, which has never changed in all of human life. While everything is different, nothing has changed as far as humans are concerned. And yet people seem to forget that we're dealing with humans. Another wild card is the completely unknown. We make fun of the guys who said we'll never get to the moon. Well, why? They were perfectly right. They did nothing wrong to make that assumption, because from the framework that they were working, they were 100% right. We could never get to the moon, because what they didn't know was rocket technology would ever be thought of, conceived, invented, constructed, and it would work. So in the absence of knowing, thinking that there could be such a thing, then your prediction is right. We'll never get to the moon. So therefore, those who think that in insurance, the law might never change to allow a company in Singapore to never even have to set foot in this country but sell insurance to people in this country, to Singapore, we'll have an argument. You'll tell me subsection 4 of the Act says that thou shalt not and whatever. Yeah, fine. But there is the unknown, and it just might happen. So you cannot be emphatic. Another wild card is the flipping moment. You went from gas to electricity. What a flip. We went from analog music, analog photography, the physical photo, the physical disc or cassette, to the digital. Analog to digital. Changed everything from marketing, sales, distribution, printing of covers, how we launch a product, customs clearance, boxing, shipping, insurance of how we ship these CDs around the world. You can now launch a song overnight anywhere. This flip just changes everything. Let us look. Electricity comes up through my legs here just to keep me up. Simon was talking about all these biosensors. Simon, I'd like one on the seat of every audience member with a little graphic here to tell me who's sort of falling asleep and who's excited. And I go, right, you in seat 7. Hello, I like you, yes. You're all excited. Let us now gaze into the future. Now, I'm not going to go too far, because if I go too far, you're all going to walk out of here and say he was a bit loopy. Really. And I'd consider it a compliment. I'd love it, really, because that's the only... Because that's really... If you agree with a futurist about what's coming into the future, they're not doing a good job. A futurist, to tell you the truth, has to... You have to hang them like they put Copernicus in jail and Galileo in jail. People don't believe things. Let's look at the smart devices. Now, we talk of smartphones. Yes, but we need ubiquity. We need smart devices that are ubiquitous, everywhere, in our carpet, on the lawn, in the wallpaper. So that, for example, with water being such a rare commodity, resource, we can't go around just watering the garden just because we think we need it. No, we need a bit more smartness, a bit more intelligence, so that we can have these kinds of devices right throughout the lawn. And then the lawn would say, excuse me, Miss Water Sprinkler, I want some here but not here. And we need to water the lawn a bit more cleverly than that. Another smart device might be that we start to learn about ourselves a bit better. We venture out into the cosmos and we want to conquer Mars and the moon, and yet we're walking around with diabetes or heart disease or some other terrible thing that's just a ticking time bomb inside us. We explore the worlds, we've got to get to know ourselves a little bit better. And the bio devices that Simon was talking to you about are just so ready and so available. And these things are just now, you know, add-ons to your smartphone, but in the future they'll just be with your smartphone, just like a clock comes with your smartphone, just like a camera now you expect with a smartphone. A biosensor will just be a normal thing, just like CD-ROM drives were once a separate product you would buy with your computer. Now the CD-ROM drive comes with your computer. Graphics card used to be an option. RAM used to be an option. Hard disk drive used to be an option. I wrote my first book, a dictionary, of 500 pages on the Mac that had no hard disk drive with a diskette. And over the days, I really enjoyed it. It was so efficient and easy. Everything happened in seconds. So in the future, this bio device will tell us. Like now, this here, what you're looking at is an ECG, electrocardiogram, or EKG. In the USA, it costs about $2,000 just to go to the doctor and they put a few things on you and read your heart signals, electrical pulses. really, it's important to do that, but $2,000, a day off work, parking, transport, it's exhausting to get one done. I think by the time you get there, the rate's already up. In Australia and New Zealand, it's about $80 plus consulting time. But now, doctors can buy this for $100, or you can buy it for $100 and just put your finger on it and send the data to your physician. Now, not only then we'll be able to know a bit more about ourselves, but as insurance providers, if we can convince our customers to be connected to our network so that we can give them a better service, a better policy, a better product, and then connect further into their toilet, their bathroom, their kitchen, their rubbish bin, their refrigerator, their desk, their seat, everything will be... Now, this at a personal level is marvellous, but at a global level, it's astronomically brilliant. Today, researchers have to beg people to come into a study group, and then you have to beg them to stay there for 3 years to do a longitudinal study to work out. But I tell you what, if we could all get the heartbeat of the world every single day, just automatically without thinking about it, we can find out some things about us as humans and be fantastic. For example, only recently, last month in Milan in Italy, researchers, quite by accident, found out that those people with Alzheimer's were half as likely to develop cancer. I thought, this can't be, what's this? And then I thought, hang on, let's look at it the other way. And they now started to look at it the other way, and they said, really? People with cancer were 35% less likely to develop Alzheimer's? And there is born, through accidents, are born. But if we had better bio devices, we wouldn't be just fumbling and begging. We'd be using data well and servicing our clients better. Let's look now at the augmentation, at the growth of biology, not just in humans, but in other things around us. Now, imagine walking home through this dark park. You're not sure what you're going to step on, who's there lurking behind the bushes. So you complain to the local council and they put lights. But that's burning a lot of fuel. Wouldn't it be good if we could understand one part of nature and fuse it with another part of nature? One part of nature says there are things in nature that glow. Even deep, deep, deep down in the darkest areas of the underworld sea, there are fishes that send out flashes of light as if there's someone there with a camera flashing. So there are things in nature that have already worked out glowing. Well, why can't we bring that in and make trees that glow to line the path from the park to our home? Why, for example, do we continue to pollute the earth by mowing lawns? This idea of grass and lawn is destroying the planet. What it takes to mow the lawns of pitches and the golf courses and our own homes, the pollution, air pollution, noise pollution, the fuel being used, the machinery, as well as the stuff to dump. Where are you going to dump all those grass clippings? Now, in nature, we have things like eyebrows, like the hair here on the arm. If you shave this, it will grow back, but grow and stop. Why then can't we develop the same augmentation here so that this lawn will grow and stop? Why does it keep growing? So there are wonderful opportunities to learn from nature, fuse one thing with another. So let's... look further, gaze into the future. Let's look at the computer speed of computing. Can you oil that for me, please, David? Where are you? Let's have a little game. I could easily ask you how old are you and all that, and you might be embarrassed. So I'm going to give you a nice, non-embarrassing way to tell me how old you are. So we're going to play a game. Ready? I'm going to play you a sound effect. And you young people in the audience, you won't have a clue what we're talking about because this is foreign to you. I'm going to play a sound effect and put your hand up or call out if you know what this is. Now, be accurate, though. Hand up. Yes? Fax machine. You... Oh, well, hang on, I have a modem and a fax machine. What else do I have? Anything else? Well, hang on a minute, listen to this one. It's a bit more choky. Actually, I cut it off because what follows from here, it just does your head in. So now what is that then? Dial-up. Do you know, you're about to meet a guy later, his name is Richard Roos, you might know from Sovereign. He not only can tell you it's a dial-up, he can tell you what speed it is. Now that is spooky, right? You know you're talking to a rev head when he can tell you that. I've got good eyesight close up, but I need glasses to see you. And someone once gave me a CD, and I can see close up just the burn marks on the CD, just a little, you know, lucky vision I have. And so I could tell it had about 400 megabytes burnt on the CD. So someone gave me a CD, and I said, wow, you want me to move 400 megabytes of data from... They said, how did you know that was 400 megs? And I lied. I love creating stories for people. I said, I can feel its weight. So there's someone out there telling, I once met this guy, he could feel it. Yeah, I love creating stories for people. One day I'd love to tell you these little mischievous things I do.
Now, hands up if you think you know.
Yes, sir. Yeah, you know, just now I thought of that after I cashed in my money last night. No, at the casino, no, I didn't. Poker machine. You know what that's telling me about you? Not only your age, but other things. Yes. Offset printer. Well, you've got a fast offset printer. Mine goes... Mine doesn't go that far. Yes.
Paper tape from an IBM computer.
Yes. Yes. That sets you back to 1860, but yes. Oh, beautiful, a telex machine, that's true. Okay, so now we're going to go back way for your grandfather's day. Tell me what this is. And what does it say? SOS. Let's look at computer speed. And you young people later, you can ask them what all that was about. What's the modern sound? Remember, that's going to be one for you in 10 years. How fast is your computer, do you think? Well, you know, we measure computers by instructions per second. What are the instructions? You know, open this, close that, transfer data, create a color, open audio files, and calculate and compute. In 1985, an average computer that you and I would have had on our desk could perhaps transact 11 million instructions per second. Mind-boggling. But as time developed, up until now, we're reaching 200 billion. Just for an average computer you've probably got in your bag right now. Of course, it's not obedient to you because it's doing its own thing and, you know, in the spinning wheel and just you wait, go make a cup of coffee till I finish doing my 200 billion, but that's what it's doing. However, I call this here at 1 second amazing, but not really, even though back then what you do today in 1 second would have taken 4.5 hours. But I still call this child's play. It is not good enough. A lot better has to be done. And you want to see already what is being done is this notion of supercomputing. I would buy one of these, except they're $400 million at least. Each of these racks that looks like a refrigerator is 2,200 kilograms. This whole system needs 12,000 litres of water to cool it down every minute. It can calculate, as you see here, 34 million billion calculations per second. What does that look like? Well, if every man, woman, child, baby, infant were given a calculator and told to calculate day and night, as fast as we can, non-stop, for 56 days, 7 billion people calculating non-stop for 56 days, this computer can do it in 1 second. Great computer. The electricity it uses is $10 million worth of electricity a year. The heat it gives off can heat or light up 5,000 homes. So it looks like a nice little thing, but let me show you the back end to this. I'm about to show you Google's back end. Google uses these kinds of computers, and that's the back end to that computer. just to keep it cool. It doesn't do anything else. And you can see the Google colors, but this could well be the tax department, Department of Defense, or any major corporation. I think sovereign's heading this way, isn't it? And this is just one of dozens of Google establishments with tens of thousands of computers and tens of thousands of servers and thousands of routers and hundreds of thousands of hard disk drives with every search you've ever done and every search I've ever done based on our IP address. However, I look at this. Now, I don't know what you feel, but I feel this. Peanuts. This is nothing. It is hopeless and pointless and will not take us across to the future. Because, as an example, prime numbers are vital for us, and the latest, largest prime number discovered in January this year was 17 million digits. If you had to write it down, you'd have to sit there writing 17 million, comma, comma, digits. Yet, to arrive at that, it took 39 days and 1,000 computers. Come on, every time you think of an idea, you can't wait 39 days for a result. That's why I call this peanuts. It's not good enough. It can't sustain us into the future. And you might think, well, Jonah, that's only for the, you know, the Richard Roos of the world. Who of us needs to know all this? Well, you see, if we had to develop with our biotech, our DNA is 3 billion letters. What, you're going to press a button and go and on holiday for 9 months in Europe and come back to check the results? It's not going to happen. In mathematics, there's a thing called factorization. If you want to factor a large number that is 1,000 digits long, it would take every single computer on the planet 20 billion years to calculate that number. Well, so that's not going to happen, but there is a solution. And the solution is quantum computing. This means that instead of taking 20 billion years, we can take just simply 1 hour. Does that blow your mind or what? And then people would say, yes, but really, what's the application for that? Well, let's start at the high end and come down to Earth. The first kind of thing to remember is that we need to understand our world and our space a bit better. What are we looking at here, please? Not stars. Galaxies. What we're looking at here is not a star. We're looking at every single dot is a galaxy. Every single dot contains somewhere around 400 billion stars. Do you want me to pause for 10 minutes while you think about that? Every dot, 400, this is a real photo, 400 billion stars. If you were to travel from one end of the dot to the other end of the dot, you would need to travel at 300,000 kilometers per second for 150,000 years. That's 186,000 miles per second for 150,000 years from just the one dot. Now, do we need quantum computers to try and understand this? And the funny thing is, what you're looking at here is only 20% of what's really there, because most often, not most often, it's a fact, that space we can only see 20% of. This is 20% of what's there, because the other stuff is hidden because it's called black matter. It's there, but we can't see it. Another thing is, what you're looking at here is really one dot in the sky. So if we take the camera to this one dot in the sky and look, that's what we're looking at. So imagine, therefore, 360 degrees, how big the sky is. Let me give you an expression of what one dot in the sky looks like. I'm going to walk off stage, and if my guys want to dim the lights, they may, because we've got to understand this and where quantum computing comes in. And if you think that's all too big and too high, okay, well, let's come down to the other end of town then. Equally mind-blowing, viruses, cells, atoms, nuclei, what are we going to do with that? What if you say encryption technology, computer security? We need that high-end computing. Space, weather, these are cyclone patterns. We must be able to calculate tsunamis much faster than we think we can now, including earthquakes, because most of the world's population is now drifting towards major centers. So one cyclone in one area could devastate millions of people. What about more practical things? This is the Google car. It can drive by itself. You can see it here going at high speed, going around random witches' hats and not hitting any one of them. Now, for this car to calculate what it has to do, it has to work every single dog and cat and leaf and tree and bump in the road and where it's going and how much fuel you've got and which other car's coming and which pedestrian and bicycle's around. And imagine if a city centre says, we won't allow these cars unless we as a city centre can have control of every car. Do you need a quantum computer now for a million cars in a city? Fuel is such a big problem for us. This is a mundane, dirty product that has served us well, but we've been stupid for a long time. We dig it up out of the ground, we destroy the earth, we have wars about it, and the price is going to continue up and up. And the idea that as, you know, people in our industry now, why do we keep driving to see customers? Why do customers keep driving to see us when a lot of the things that we can do in insurance and services can be done online? Without losing touch of the human touch, which is vital, the experience, which is vital, but where possible, people want you to save them time, traffic, and fuel, and money. And where's that going? Pollution, costs, problems. So someone said, hang on a minute, but what about solar energy?
Yes.
Now, before I said to you, child's play. And then I said to you, peanuts. Well, they're trying to make it really fascinating. 40,000 panels, the size of each of these panels. So these solar panels are the size of these screens, one of them. And they move with the... And then now they're making them with 80,000. Look how big it is, entire massive farmland. So child's play, peanuts. What do I call this? Chicken feed. The sun. The sun, solar, the sun. Do you know how big the sun is? You can fit 109 Earths across the sun. You could fit a million Earths inside the sun. And we want to just stand there like a little guana picking up a little heat. You want sun. You want power. We've got to understand what the sun is. 10 million degrees at its core. You want to play with the sun, mate. Get into fierce fuel and stop this. Oh, let's look at the sun's rays and have solar energy. But this is coming. Brace yourself, this is coming. We will be able to produce the most amazing power that's clean. Well, how is that? Not by tapping into the sun, but by thinking like the sun thinks and working like the sun works. How does the sun do what it does? Nuclear fusion. It takes hydrogen atoms and compresses them, collapses them. It's called implosion. And that creates the 10 million degrees. Well, if we can understand nuclear fusion, why don't we just replicate the sun on Earth? And they are doing that. Here is the centre called the Livermore Centre, and they have constructed 150 tonnes of a chamber. Massive chamber that has been installed in a 5-storey building, and it's ready to go. What happens is, at one end of this factory facility, is a laser show, much like the laser I'm holding in my hand. But this is too wide. Their laser is finer than human hair. And it starts the journey. As the journey gets going, this fine, thin as hair laser becomes 42 centimetres and goes through not one, but 192 of these through prisms and mirrors until you are dealing with a force so grand and it meets at the end once more to become as fine as human hair to produce 50 million degrees, which is 5 times more than the core of the sun. And what's that called? And what's that about? You can now light up any major city at its peak and run every air conditioner, factory, machine, lift, and whole center for 3 months by that laser light coming at the end and hitting a pellet the size of sand or grain of sugar. And that pellet is a hydrogen pellet. and it implodes in the chamber, dead center of the chamber. That light beam just hits the one tiny pellet, and the byproduct, helium. So we'll all be running around laughing, gaggling our head off. Hello. But it'd be worth it. Well, now we have to ask ourselves, the future looks fantastic. It always does, if we know how to build a bridge to it, not fall over the ditch or have us hit in the face like a brick wall. But we can, luckily, learn from the past. And what can we learn from the past about how to embrace the future and how to welcome the future and understand the future? These things I call maxims or life lessons, and here are a few. And the first one is this idea of the wow factor. We here, we deal in insurance, we sell peace of mind, we sell an intangible product, and yet still it is vital that we engage in wow. And wow stands for worth or wealth. For some people, it's worth a lot that you have this clause or that feature. For others, it's not. For others, it's worth a lot that you're available 24 hours. Others, it's not. So what I'm saying, therefore, is every customer has a different dispographic. Every customer will value something to their way. And sometimes, just peace of mind is worth more to them than saving a few dollars. Now, the thing with worth or wealth is that over time, no matter what it is, it doesn't look good. But when it starts out, it's high. Wow, we just invented the TV. You go, wow. And then we open a hotel chain and we say, in each of our hotel rooms, we have a TV. And we're the first to do that. You go, wow, I'm going to stay at that hotel. I get a TV in the room. But over time, like now, you wouldn't see an ad for a hotel saying, come stay at our hotel. We have a TV in every room. You think, you jolly well should. I expect it. So now what? So it diminishes, the wow factor diminishes. So we must always be high, but must always reinvigorate and reinvent and regrow. And that's why I showed you the duck and the sitting duck syndrome. So now they say, no, hang on. Yeah, I know everyone's got a TV, but we have color. Do you know driving through country towns, you see this thing, color TV, yeah? And now they have cable and widescreen and internet and Xbox and, yeah, so you have to keep shifting the bar. You can buy our car, we have a cassette player. Yep. Oh, buy our car, we have a CD player. Yeah, now I expect you to. But buy our car and we have all the iTunes, the 12 billion songs on iTunes you can download. In fact, you don't download. Download's an old thinking. You can just stream and listen to ad hoc. You don't have to buy one. You just subscribe, $30 a month. Oh, wow, my car's got an IP address. The BMW 8 Series, while you are driving, detects the tires and inflates them for you while you are driving. You don't have to wait to go out and pump your tire. So you keep adding the wow factor, and that, therefore, is the lesson. But people will say, I don't have time. They'll say, I don't have money. They'll say, I don't have technology. I'm exhausted. One wow factor is enough for me. No, mate. Now, time, money, and technology. In my lifetime, if I had to give an award for something that was mind-boggling for me, I'd give an award to this. The A380 for me is just unbelievable engineering. $500 million if you want to buy this aeroplane. And I was lucky enough to fly on it when it first came out because I had to go to Europe. My client was flying me there. I was lucky enough to be in a business class seat, and I just fronted up. I didn't know anything about it, and all of a sudden I'm on A380. I thought, wow, fantastic. It boasted the world's first fully flat bed. I've never, ever slept on a flight, and I thought, for the first time ever, I'm going to sleep. So I get in, I sit down, shut up, buckle up, please, ding, ding, shut up, whatever, you know, they tell you to... And it was the most uncomfortable seat I have ever sat in, business or economy. It was a flat seat, as flat as this stage, wide, but the seatbelt was here, so I couldn't lean over to lean on the thing on this side. This side I couldn't lean on anything because it tapered out, and I felt like I was just on a rattler, like a train. And I thought, I'm so exhausted, I just want to recline. And that's as far back as it reclined. Where's my fully flat bed? Oh, well, you have to get up and click, clack, push, shove, move. Hey, excuse me, ding, ding. Can I have a seatbelt? Next one. Can I have the mattress? Yes, thank you. You're coming. No. And I was, you know how listless you get sometimes, so tired you can't even be bothered to turn off the heater, and you know the iron's going to burn the house down. You think, I'm just too tired. Well, that's what you are when you're traveling five cities in a row and you're just exhausted. And I said, this is a $9,000 seat. Where are the features? Now, being who I am, you can understand this, I go looky-looky. So I thought, am I the only stupid one here? So I went taking photos. And here's a man who paid $9,000 for his seat in a $500 million aeroplane, And that's his idea of comfort. And that's how I was sitting. Because these people had all the money and all the technology and all the ideas and all the innovation, and what happened? They didn't think about adding wow, worth or wealth from the bottom end of town. What good is all this stuff if you can't so much as think about the client's perspective? Consumer behavior. People evaluate a product objectively and they are persuaded subjectively. So our customers go through their mind in nanoseconds, they're spinning between objective evaluation and subjective persuasion, whether they're buying insurance or a gold diamond ring or whatever. Objective evaluation means I evaluate the object. What's the object here? A car. What is it? Rubber, metal, glass, electronics. What's a diamond ring? Rock, metal. That's the object. Does it have steering? Yep. Does it have a sound system? Yep. Does it? Yep. So they come to you to buy insurance. What's the object? How many years? How much? Who's covered? When? How do I? Tick, tick, tick. Great. That's important for me. It's very important that the objectives are covered. But they don't make a decision on the object. They make a decision on the subject. What's the subject of metal and rubber and electronics? The subject is speed, thrill, excitement, showing off, return on investment, safety for my family, pulling my yacht behind me, power. The subject looks nothing like the object. So I think that people keep failing to embrace the future because they keep forgetting that humans haven't changed in a million years. And why do we keep losing sight of the need to deliver people a wonderful object but make sure their experience is right subjectively? They'll say, and you might say, but we're the best of breed. We're the best insurance network there is. We're the best insurance company. Yeah, that you might be true, but they're saying to you, I want it a little bit differently. So I'll explain that to you in a minute as we go here. The other reason I think people fail is that they don't understand information. We are so data crazy. We've got data centers coming out of our ears. We have data on everything. But how many times does that data sing like a sheet of music? We need data to not just sit all over the place in sales and marketing and governance and finance. We must bring it together in a score sheet and must always sing and must be on and must be flowing so that it is always in motion and it has form and structure. I used to belong to a company, a telecommunications company in Australia that provided for me my internet service. Fine. $89 I paid, got this much download, no problem. One day over a coffee, a friend of mine said, I'm paying $59. Jonah, you're paying $89. And I'm getting this much download. And Jonah, you're getting this much download. And I thought, hang on a minute. So being the researcher that I am, I poked and I said, excuse me, I've been a customer for 10 years. Why have you been ripping me off for the last year, giving me this much? And you can see the kind of graphics I use. I need data. And I'm sitting there, you know, And they said to me, well, it's up to you to work out and, you know, check our website periodically. Up to me, I've been a customer for 10 years. Why couldn't you tell me you had a better service? Why couldn't, the rip-off factor I felt out of that, the anger that gets, you know, and I've got this letter, it's just waiting to be blogged. I've got a blog site with 600 articles on there. I guess this will be 601, just wait till I get back to Sydney. So, stupidity, information. Therefore, if we are to embrace the future, does your data really inform you? Are you really hearing the symphony, or is it just name, address, phone number, yep, goodbye, thank you very much, give us your money, shut up. It has to be alive. And with the biodata that we can get from these people, showing them that we're fully in tune with what they are saying, and we know they've just had a baby, and have you thought about this? Well, what is this? This is called typical selling that we've known about for a million years. And I know you know this, but I'm just telling you, this is why people fail, because they forget it. Finally here, second last is BYO. Customers want to be able to build their own. And you might say, but insurance doesn't work like that. Yeah, no, but Nike does. You know, you can, for a long time now, you could design your Nike up, sole, down, every single thing that is different element here can be colored by you. You can design cars like this. Go to Porsche.com, Ferrari.com. You can design every single element of any button, colors, carpet, anything. So their experience here, And now they come to you to buy insurance. You say, no, you have to wait 30 days. And no, you can't do it this way. And no, you have to buy this whole package even though you're not married. I still have to sign that I'm not pregnant. I travel the world. I still have to sign. I go, the doctor sends me to get a scanny thing. I have to sign that I'm not pregnant in case I go into the scanner and kill the baby. Haven't anyone sorted this out yet? So although you do what you do well and perhaps the best in your industry, you are competing with Nike. And the customer wants it not only to be built their way in their language. So when you say, here you go, here's a form, what makes you think these people want to read anyway? Why can't it be set to music? Why can't it be set to a song? Why can't it be a video? Why can't it be a pod that they can listen to when they're jogging? Why do they have to read? Why can't it be in Italian or Mandarin? Why does it have to be in English? So these kinds of things to embrace our world will make us winners or losers. So let the client build their own and observe how they prefer to communicate. 24 hours at night, at midnight, at 2 a.m. Well, you can decide not to, but there is the case study of why people fail and why they don't. And it is not enough to be linked. We are linked to every butcher in the world. So what? The telephone links us to everything. The internet links us to everything. Doesn't mean anything. I could be the dirtiest person in the world and live in a soap factory and remain the dirtiest person in the world unless I apply the soap to my skin. We can have all this data and all this technology and all these networks. What good are they if we don't apply them to this intelligence that we have? Now, apply means application. App. The app store, apparently, is an app store. And I say to people, what's an app? Oh, I don't know. App. Application. Oh, yeah, software. No, application is not software. Application is a verb, to apply this to that. So it is not enough to link. We have to connect people. We are linked to every business in the city, but how many of them are connected to me, to you, and vice versa, we to our clients? And I've had wonderful fun being here today. I thank Sovereign and my friends here for having me. In a moment, I'll hand you over to Sovereign's Chief Distribution Officer, Mr. David Hark. But for now, I say I thank you.